Whether Cebu is already the new epicenter of the novel coronavirus or still just a worsening virus hotspot doesn't make much of a difference anymore. The fact is, COVID is wreaking havoc there and could cause the same paralyzing disruptions to the economy in the Visayas the way it did Metro Manila. How is the business sentiment there? Cebu Landmasters COO Franco Soberano joins us live. Hi Franco, good afternoon.
Hi, Mimi. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for joining us.
Nice to be here.
Great to have you. So, Franco, how are you guys in Cebu? How is Cebu holding up? Because we know that ECQ has been extended there until July 15th. I mean, what sort of disruptions are businesses encountering there?
Well, Mimi, everyone here is saying, and our leaders are saying, it's a necessary one step backward, but two steps forward. I think Cebu being so important to the Philippines, being a gateway to the South, through this process, we need to instill a higher level of confidence, safety, and security so that Cebu City can emerge even stronger, not just in the next month, but even in the medium and long term.
Mm-hmm.
So it's been a more concerted effort, maybe, when we were reverted back to ECQ status. We can see here that it's a more concerted effort. The strict measures are in place and heavily enforced.
Mm-hmm. So under ECQ, has construction work in your project stopped? Are you seeing difficulties in getting your construction workers to and from the work sites? Are raw materials delayed?
Well, Cebu Landmasters is in 15 key cities. So Cebu City is one of it. Mandaue, sites like Naga, San Fernando are already operating on GCQ, so there are no issues there.
Mm-hmm.
Sites are ramping up back to 100%. But in Cebu City, for essential private construction like depot-related or housing-related, there is a minimal workforce to support operations because there are deadlines to deliver, and we have also some livelihoods we want to protect for our workers.
And what is the minimal? By minimal workforce, you mean 50% of workers?
Less than 50%, maybe.
Oh, wow, less than 50%. But Franco, you know, here's an interesting chart from your team showing reservation sales in the first half of this year, 7.4 billion, I think, that's already 60 to 65% of your full year 2019 sales. And that big jump actually came in the second quarter. In the thick of COVID-19, you guys seem to have had a field day back then when most everyone else took a bad hit. How do you explain this big jump during the Q2 period?
To be honest, this even surprised our own internal expectations. I think this is the result of the growth we've been invested in for the last 5 years or since we went IPO.
Mm-hmm.
We're in 15 different cities now. We're in all the housing segments. We're in also mixed-use markets. But I think maybe in this crisis, what's magnified is that housing is tantamount to general health. Mm-hmm. There is really a rush to invest in a person's security, safety, and home ownership definitely provides that. As we know, there's that housing backlog to begin with. Vismin accounts for 2.8 million of the 7 million housing backlog. So this 4.5 billion the second quarter is actually our highest quarterly performance of all time. So it's a welcome news in this difficult environment, but it also shows that there is still that capacity to invest, and there's that fortitude to protect their housing investment.
It does sound pretty counterintuitive, you know, when the economy is doing badly, people are actually spending to buy themselves homes. But could it be, Franco, I'm just playing devil's advocate here,
yeah,
that you're not out of the woods yet. In fact, you haven't even peaked. That the reason why Q2 was good, because at that time you weren't even peaking yet. That you could actually risk peaking later on, possibly in the third quarter. Do you think is this part of the outlook for Q3, and could this derail this year's stellar performance so far?
I think, Mimi, we've been on, well, Cebu City in particular has been on quarantine for almost 4 months,
mm-hmm,
while the rest of Vismin have actually been on lighter or more ease restrictions for the last 2 months. So I think it would be safe to say that we're not yet out of the woods, but there are some bright indicators that this housing market will be well supported. And
mm-hmm,
I'd like to say that the one major indicator that all developers are looking at are cancellation rates. Mm-hmm. And from Cebu Landmasters side, we're very happy to share that cancellation rates remain very low at less than 2%. This shows how important the protection for the home is, or that housing is really more long-term in horizon, long-term in investment, and people will really take care of that.
Mm-hmm.
And as far as liquidity, we have sites like Cagayan de Oro, in Iloilo, Bacolod, where banks are still approving home loans. And it's a good sign that liquidity is there. And we're hopeful the market will recover, and Cebu Landmasters will continue providing that guidance to the market.
Mm-hmm. Frank, I know that CLI has very little to zero exposure to POGOs, correct?
Yes, we have zero POGO exposure, Mimi, and zero POGO tenants.
Okay, so, but you do depend on the BPOs and OFWs.
Yes, correct. We have over five office buildings, and there are some good indicators. We're getting more inquiries now for spaces, especially those in the e-commerce or logistics sector.
Mm-hmm.
And we have one building in the Cebu Business Park that's completing next quarter, and we're very excited about the interest in the building and mm-hmm. and soon to be taken up building.
Franco, of course, in the BPO side, it looks great. The outlook looks great because everybody, you know, when we all get back to work, people are going to think of ways to cut costs, and foreign companies could look into outsourcing some of the progress or sort of the work that they need to do. But it's the OFW remittance side that's pretty problematic, because the World Bank expects global remittances this year to decline by 20%, with remittance inflows to East Asia and Pacific seen to decline by 13%. OFW remittances for Philippines is seen falling by about 10%. How do you think this will impact your balance sheet?
Well, as I said, based on the last 4 months, we've mm-hmm. maintained a very low cancellation rate of less than 2%.
Mm-hmm.
But what's interesting to point out, Mimi, is our OFW investors are usually 40% of our buyers, and they mostly invest in the economic or affordable segment.
Mm-hmm.
In the last quarter where we registered $4.5 billion of sales, 80% of our buyers are from the local market. So there is that small shift of the buyer base and urgency.
Mm-hmm.
But we really see this slight OFW slowdown as temporary, as the European markets are reopening. And we're going to continue keeping an eye on those indicators, Mimi.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about your pipeline, a pretty impressive pipeline. You have 14 projects with $19.4 billion for launch this year. Everything is launching as scheduled?
Yes. We are inspired by our Q2 performance. So mm-hmm. of the 14 projects, we've actually launched 5 already. That includes projects in Bohol, in Iloilo, and we're looking now to launch more housing in Cagayan de Oro, in Davao, in mm-hmm. Dumaguete, even in Ormoc.
Mm-hmm.
And based on what we forecasted in March, we're just very happy that we will be able to roll out the 14 projects that we plan to do so this year.
I think we have a map of your projects and where they are located, but all in all, you've got 42 ongoing projects. Still ongoing, as I mentioned. Isn't today the worst time to be caught in the middle of construction?
If I would have to break down the 42 further, half of those 42 are actually completed or nearing completion,
okay.
While the other half are newly launched or just started. The good thing is all our projects are funded. We have very strong relationships with the banking sector, and I think it's now looking at the quality accounts, no? Quality accounts with strong sales, and all these projects are practically sold out on our side, and that gives some reassurances to the banks who are supporting us.
And do you think, final question, Franco, the central bank, the Philippine Central Bank, has been pretty aggressive in cutting interest rates. Do you think this is going to give your business, the whole real estate sector, a big boost because of cheap money, essentially?
Yes, definitely. Even with our upcoming projects, we have been assured of support by our banking partners. liquidity is really still there, and I think we have our recent performance to show for and to give confidence to the bank. So it's a very good move by our central bank. And any support would be definitely good for housing market, for the developers market, and as you know, the real estate has a lot of related industries. It's also help import the finishing materials industry, cement industry, housing market. So it's an industry that the government should keep supporting.
And hopefully, with low interest rates, banks will still be willing to lend them out amid concerns or fears that we're going to have a lot of bad loans out there. Thank you very much, Franco, for joining us this afternoon.
Thank you, Mimi, and take care.